Ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, it's a great pleasure to have you in the room, those of you that are in the room, and those of you outside, come in. It's interesting. So we're starting the session on forests. It's the trading forests and climate change. That's a very important point because, I don't know, of you in the room, has anyone felt the experience of being in the middle of a forest and feeling the sounds and the smells and the life around them? Can I see a hand? So everybody knows what a forest is and how wonderful it is. Thanks. We will be speaking today about forests, but not only in the sense of, you know, the cultural value, the environmental value, but how this is an important step in addressing climate change and life on Earth in terms of biodiversity as well, but also the problems that we need to address in order to keep those forests that we all know how important they are. I'm Spyros Kouvelis. I'm the director of the Institute for Sustainable Development of the European Public Law Organization, and it is my great privilege to be here with the Delphi Forum with a wonderful array of three speakers. I'll start with my longtime friend, Ms. Dionysia Avgerinopoulou, who is the chair of the Special Committee of the Hellenic Parliament on the Environment, Environmental Protection. Dionysia, thank you for being with us. Konstantinos Aravossis, the General Secretary for Forests at the Ministry of the Environment, also a longtime friend. And last but not least, Mr. Dimitris Karavellas, the director of WWF Greece. With Dimitris, we go that far back that we have actually swum with a monk seal in Zakynthos, I don't know how many years back. One of the best biologists I've known in my life. So thank you for being with us all together. We will speak about the forest, but I want to go straight into our discussion. We have only half an hour, so we'll try to keep our what we say in like 5 minutes, 5 to 7 minutes, and then we'll go around to have this as a discussion. And I can speak to you with your first names, right? So, Theodora, I'd like to ask you first, as an elected member of parliament and also a lady, you have been doing quite a lot of work on the Parliament Environment Committee on Forests. You have spoken about the National Reforestation Plan, put up a lot of deliberations and recommendations about what needs to be done. And I know that you have also been connecting this to climate change very significantly, also through your international activity. Would you like to tell us a bit about how the take from the committee in the parliament is about the reforestation plan, the need to work for forests in Greece?
Sure, thank you very much for the question. And I do enjoy being here today with you in this discussion because I also know your international activity on relevant issues. So on behalf of the Greek Environment Committee of the parliament, we participate in many international fora. And one of them happens to be the COPs, the Conference of the Parties of the UNFCCC, the UN Agreement for Climate Change. And there, the discussions about the connection between the forest preservation and the forest restoration and the win in our combating climate change is very obvious for many reasons. First of all, because we have these statistics that every time that a forest is being deforestating, then there are a lot of CO2 emissions into the atmosphere. And actually, the actual contribution of the forest destruction contributes to the significant percentage of 17% of the global CO2 emissions. So we really need to halt the forest loss in order to halt climate change. And also, for the forest reforestation and preservation contributes to climate change mitigation and adaptation. So we have another nexus there. For example, if we restore our forests, then we have more zincs, natural zincs for carbon dioxide. And if we preserve our forests, then we definitely have the natural mechanisms to at the same time halt the floods, halt soil erosion, and biodiversity loss. Because we need to keep in the back of our minds that at least 80% of our global biodiversity lives in forests. And the health of our planet, the ecosystem balance, really depends on the health of the forests. Taking that into account, the Environment Committee of the Parliament participates both in these international agreements and processes and also in the agreements that take place within the EU and also in the Mediterranean sphere. And we hold that it is very important to support the Global Forest Finance Pledge in order to give at least $1 billion dollars in order to halt biodiversity and forest loss and help developing countries. And we also upheld the global goal for the replant, the restoration of at least 1 trillion trees by 2030 on our way to achieve the net zero emissions by 2050. In Greece, what we kindly requested and advised to the Greek government, I'm very happy that the Greek government actually agreed to this suggestion on behalf of the Environment Committee, is that we have a very bold national reforestation plan. And the Greek government actually decided that we should have more than 20 million trees by 2025, and there is a very generous contribution on behalf of the government taking out of the RRF, the Recovery and Resiliency Plan of Greece, of at least 200 million euros in order to support this plan. By closing, I would like to emphasize on the need not only to create new forests, but most importantly, to preserve old forests, because old forest is very important biodiversity on behalf of biodiversity and also as a zinc. And this is why the Environment Committee of the Parliament decided to have another suggestion, to preserve as pristine sources for the environment every tree that is in Greece today and is more than 200 years old. And the Greek government also supported this proposal, and now we have a new platform for old trees. And we're very, very proud of this.
Thank you so much, Theodora. And it's good to see that there are actually implementable ideas that come out of your committee. I think that the Environmental Committee in Parliament can really make a big difference, and I'm very happy that you're directing it in this direction. I'll now turn to the General Secretary for Forest, Mr. Aravossis Konstantine. Theodora told us that this is a big national reforestation plan. In my view, it's one of the biggest we've ever seen in Europe. Would you like to tell us a bit more about what this plan entails, the when, the how, the why we heard it, but how you will implement this plan and the importance that it has, not only for addressing climate change, but for also helping the socioeconomic sides of human, of life of people in Greece?
Yes, thank you very much for this question, Spyros. And you know that I'm here with my new position as Secretary General for Forests. And you know that this is a new General Secretariat. And this emphasizes the fact that the Prime Minister himself has addressed after the mega fires of this summer that there has to be a new General Secretary for Fires, for Forests, because it is central in our environmental policies. So we have a new 10-year national strategy concerning forest management, and there actions that have to do with reforestation but also with afforestation are central. For the first time, we have this plan for reforestation for the next 10 years that has to do with 30 million trees that have to be planted. And this concerns a funding of 700 million euros. It is the first time that we have such a program, such a plan for Greece. And it starts right away. It is included in the RRF funding. We are going to apply 200 million right away for the next 3 years. And there is going to be reforestation in an area of 17,000 hectares. So it's a huge program, a huge plan that starts right away. And it has also to do with our policies that are included in our new climate law that is going to be and to pass through the parliament within the next month. There, the companies have the alternative and the opportunity, because there will be targets for the companies to reduce the emissions by 30% by 2030. And if this is not possible, they have the alternative to go into investments concerning reforestation in order to compensate the carbon emissions that they have to have as a target. So this is something very important. Apart from that, I would like to say that concerning our reforestation plan, we start right away, we have already started with a pilot plan that will incorporate new technologies in reforestation. And I think it is very important to say that now in our new policies, technology will play a very important and crucial role. As you know, it is possible now to monitor forests and forest areas through modern and innovative technologies, for example, satellite technologies, GPS. GIS is a very important tool, and you can also use sensors that can monitor what is going on concerning certain parameters in the forest, and so the forest offices that we have all around the country will be able through these technologies to monitor effectively what is going on in the forest, mm-hmm. and also to find ways of protection.
Because I will stop you here, because we'll come back to the issue of how we can prevent forest fires the next round. I'd like to stay for a minute in the discussion about the reforestation plan and the need to have living forests rich in biodiversity to preserve the old growth forests that you mentioned, Theodora. I'd like to turn to Dimitri Karavellas, director of WWF Greece, because the issue of preserving forests, both in terms of climate change and biodiversity, but also protecting them from forest fires, is very important. And I would like you to start, Dimitri, from the first part, the importance and how you have been through the organization of WWF showing Greece for many years now how proper management can be done, and then just kick the ball around the forest fires issue, and we'll go for the next round.
Okay, well, thanks for the question, Spiros. I wanted to start with a more general observation around the issue of forests and our relation with forests, especially in this country, but also throughout the Mediterranean. And I think that the reality is that we have actually, in Greece and the Mediterranean, taken forests and nature, I would say, for granted for many years. We have not managed forests for decades. We have still to complete forestry maps. We've changed land use and lost forests to agriculture and to urban development. We've consistently proven unsuccessful in addressing the issue of forest fires. Now, forest fires is a natural phenomenon in Mediterranean ecosystems, of course, not at this scale, intensity, and frequency. And the numbers are really staggering. We, over the last 20 years, every year we have something like 10,000 forest fires in Greece. On average, we lose about 50,000 hectares per year. Some years it's less, some years it's much more. Last year, as we all know, was much, much more. And sadly, over the last few years, that's not only accompanied by a loss and the threat to biodiversity, but a loss to human lives and livelihoods. So I would say, in a nutshell, we have failed in being good stewards of forest and good stewards of nature. That's the setting. Now enter climate crisis. Now, I'm not going to analyze this. In the last session, we had really good, I think there was a really good discussion around the reports of the IPCC and what that says. But I think in relation to forests, climate crisis means two things. forests become much more valuable because of their vast mitigation potential, firstly. And secondly, forests become much more vulnerable. And we've seen that the hard way in Greece and in the Mediterranean through megafires. So that's the situation. And it's clear that, Spyros, something has to change drastically. And if we focus that discussion right now in forests in Greece, and maybe focus a bit more on forest fires, and we think about what needs to change, I think there are three or four critical things. Firstly, we need to change the paradigm around managing forest fires. We need to move away from the paradigm of suppression to one of prevention. From 2016 to 2020 in Greece, 84% of the funds for forest fires went to suppression. 84%, okay? In the RRF, there are 1.8 billion euros that are going to be invested in suppression, a small fraction of that in prevention. What does prevention mean? It means management plans. It means actually managing our forests. A very, very small fraction of forests in Greece are actually actively managed, and it means benefiting from the forests in that. Actively, it means collaboration between, for example, the Forest Fire Service and the fire brigade and the forest fire the forest service. It means local prevention plans so that we don't have again the tragedies of Mati or of Evia. And I think there needs to be a very, very strong priority there geographically in those areas where we have settlements mixed with forests. And for better or worse, we actually have a number of those places in Greece. So the one thing is shifting the paradigm. The second point I wanted to emphasize is the role of society. It may come as a surprise, but actually the vast majority of forest fires in Greece are not because of arson. They're because of negligence. They're because of stupidity. People that aren't aware of the fact that just doing something with 8 before wind, lighting a fire to burn some leaves, can actually
lead to... Not necessarily a good idea.
Yeah. So there needs to be more awareness, active awareness, and educating around that. The third point I wanted to make, and I think we saw this very strongly after the summers of last fire, is we're actually seeing, and it's a hopeful point, we're actually seeing a number out of society, a number of individuals, groups coming together, organizing themselves, and really wanting to assist in the issue of forest fires, both from the prevention side and from the suppression side. And I think it's time that we actually organize, capitalize, empower those groups so that they can really actively be engaged in this. There was a law that was passed in Greece 2 years ago, 4662, which was actually all about bringing on those volunteer teams. That law still really hasn't been activated, so much more needs to be done in that. And the final point I wanted to make is about all the policies around this. Yes, reforestation might be needed in some cases. I say might because Mediterranean ecosystems actually do have regenerating powers, and Mother Nature, when left to do her job, can do her job very well. Reforestation might be needed in those areas that have been burned 2 or 3 times, and there are issues around what species are used, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But the main thing we need to do is to protect the existing forests. And that means the appropriate policies, that means finalizing the forestry maps, it means putting in place management, it means management of protected areas that are 30% of the surface of Greece. So just in a nutshell, I would say, we haven't done things right over the last 20 or 30 years. Because of the climate crisis, forests are becoming a lot more valuable and vulnerable, and there are clear things that we need to be doing yesterday if we want to change this.
Thank you, Dimitri. I have to comment that in the past, we had only one case where there was a general secretariat for forests. We'll know of the former secretary general. And now it's again a good opportunity because Konstantinos, it's not because we know each other for a long time, but he is a doer. And I think that it's an opportunity to see the things that you said being implemented on the ground. So I will start from giving you again the floor to tell us a few more things about the technology and how science and technology can be a very strong part of both managing, protecting the forests, and also doing the work for the suppression of forest fires. But then I will circle back, because both Dimitris and Theodora, they have very close links to the ground. I mean, your region in Ilia has been very badly struck from forest fires. You, Dimitri, you have very good examples of how the involvement of people, forest of Dadia, in Souffli, for example, is protected by the people that live out of the forest, and that these are great examples. So we'll come back to the governance and importance of involving the different stakeholders, but let's stick for a minute to the technology, because that is a very strong evolution in time. Things are developing very much in real-time systems, in awareness systems, in all that. Konstantinos, would you like to tell us a bit more things?
Of course, but first of all, I would like to say that I fully agree with Dimitris. Our priority is prevention. Now it's the main strategy. And we have really started doing something real. We already invest 50 million euros for prevention measures to clean up forests all around the country. And this happens for the first time this year. Okay, and so, and apart from that, forest fire prevention plans are going to be developed all over Greece. We start right away. Now, concerning technology. Technology is really, in our opinion, the tool in order to be able to achieve the targets and the tasks that have to do with effective protection of forests. Because it is like in a plant, in the industry, where it is possible to to monitor all activities of a plant in a panel, in a computer, and see exactly what is going on, exactly the same can be applied to forests. This is something that is for us a focus. This is where we want to go. And with modern technology, it is possible to monitor forests all around Greece. And here, the thing that we need is a plan to go on and to go to this towards this way. And it is also possible for the people that work in the forest offices all around Greece that are much less than we would like them to be. Through technology, they will be able to have higher productivity and to be able to really ensure protection of forests.
Thank you very much. I have to comment first that it's very interesting when you hear the Secretary General of the Ministry expressing that he agrees with an NGO. It's not true that he always disagrees, and we have seen many cases, but it just reminds me, many years ago when I was in Parliament, I was in the opposition, and the current Prime Minister, Mitsotakis, Kyriakos Mitsotakis, was in your position, actually, the chair of the Environment Committee. We were in a radio program, and we were agreeing, because on these things, there are not many things you can disagree. I mean, it's common sense that you need to protect forests and all that. I remember the journalist saying, guys, don't agree so much, the numbers are falling. Please fight a bit. So don't fight today, but just keep it in mind. Okay, technology is very important, and I want to say that I have actually witnessed many cases where there is technology. There are cases, I was speaking recently with the head of the National Observatory of Athens in the prediction part, where they have actually created very strong models on which they can actually foresee the deployment and the development of a forest fire based on the initial minutes of a breakout of a fire, towards which direction and how it will evolve. Unfortunately, and I have to say that, in many cases, this is not consulted. What you said, Dimitri, about the different services working together is very important. But I want to go one step back. One thing about proper governance, how the different sectors will work together, has to do with how the authorities, the research institutions will work together. But then there is other things too. You have the private sector. They need to be part of the process, not only of addressing a forest fire, but of preventing it, and also doing what needs to be done afterwards, of the rehabilitation, both in forest areas, but also in around the forest areas, in cities, in villages, and so on. It's the people that live in the land. We have seen many cases where there's evacuations, Sometimes, yes, I will agree that evacuation is necessary to protect lives. In some other cases, we should not have it as the first thing that we need to do, because people that live in the area, they know how to help you with that. You have lots of experience in this. So I'll just go first to Theodora. If you want to give us a little bit of your feeling from the ground, what happens when a forest fire like this breaks out and it changes the lives of people for dozens of years? How should we work with everyone around the proper governance plan to make this not happen, and once it has happened, to address it and redress the situation afterwards?
I could tell you just one thing, that it's only now, 15 years after the wildfires of 2007 in my region, in ancient Olympia and the region of Sahara in Elea, that we have started recovering psychologically and also economically and environmentally from that disaster. And it's only 15 years. So whenever such a fire happens, it is really bad for both the environment and the economy and the society. So we should definitely work together to prevent it. And if it happens, because it will happen for one way or another, because of negligence, because of the natural evolution in the Mediterranean forest, or because of a real goal of the fires to happen, because there are some economic, different interests there that are still working against the nature. So we need to bring every sector of society and governance together. We need to have the civil society to be educated and ready to assist, especially the people that are young and strong, and they can stay there with us, with the rest of the governmental sectors, and help. Of course, this is only our plan B, because it is not up to the citizen to actively protect the forest when a forest fire happens. It is up to the fire service, and it is up to the local authorities. The local authorities play a very crucial role, and actually, according to our governance scheme right now, it is the governor of the region that is in charge of the prevention plan and the plan of the first response. So we need to educate and give the necessary skills and tools and equipment to the first and the second degree of the local government. This is essential. And also to deploy the funds that are that should be available at the very exact time that the fire occurs. Because we had this problem during, even like last summer, we did not have available funds at the very first minute when the fire starts. We might have it after 1 or 2 days, but this is too late. So we need to have the financial flexibility to get equipment whenever we want it. Right now, because of the RRF, really, the Greek government got a lot of necessary equipment, and I think that this summer, as had the last summer as well, we're going to have more equipment and we're going to be more organized. Plus, what we also decided to do is that we created new units in order to combat the forest fires in the forest itself. So we have a new unit of the fire service that is going to be specialized in the in combating fires for the fire of the forests. And this is happening maybe for the first time. Maybe Konstantinos could give some more details on that. So our forest service, our fire service is going to be more capable into combating forest fires. And on top of that, what the government has done is that they had created a new ministry, the Ministry for Climate Change and Civil Protection. And this ministry has the mandate to prepare the government, to coordinate the government, the local authorities, the civil service, and the volunteers in order to combat the fires. We're going to have the opportunity to see how effective this ministry is this summer. Closing on this point, I would like to emphasize on the role that the private sector can play to that. The private sector right now has a new tool in its hands, because the private sector can participate to the national reforestation plan. And the private sector is going to be a very good friend of the governmental initiatives, and we can work hand by hand.
Thank you so much, Theodora. Dimitri, I'll turn back to you, because you were saying before that suppression is important when a fire breaks out, but the game changer is to make sure that it will not break out. So prevention is very important, and I would like you to comment on this in the sense of how you involve the community, you involve those that are the users of the forest, be it people that live out of taking things out of the forest, like products and everything, or using them for other uses like, I don't know, tourism or ecotourism, all that. Your organization has worked in many, many years, has been an example of how this is done in Greece. Prevention, therefore, one thing, and then on the rehabilitation issue. You said before that reforestation is an important part, and I will agree with what Konstantinos was saying, that properly done, with the proper species and everything, can make a big difference. But rehabilitation, also in the sense of how we coexist with the forest, is very important. Would you like to comment on those two things, please?
Yes. The first thing I wanted to say is we need to be aware of the reality that forest fires will continue, whatever we do. Okay. And so the challenge is really how do we contain the frequency, the severity of those fires, and that's why prevention is so very important. Now, for me, it's very, very important that we think about this within the context of what happens on the ground and locally. And that's why I said that outside of what's done at the national level, it's very, very important that we never see a situation like Mati or Evia again. And that will require those prevention plans to be put in place that are local, that are customized to the characteristics of each of the regions, and that everybody knows what their role is specifically in the months before the forest fire season. Let me just remind you, formally the fire season starts in May. We've already had fires in Rhodes and Samos and a number of places, and this is the reality we will have to face. So the roles and responsibilities and accountability are very, very clear at the local level. And you know, we may have examples. You mentioned Ravia, for example. Spiros, yes, in many places in Greece where communities actually lived in the forest and from the forest, they had the practice and still have the practice of the church bell ringing and everybody coming together and knowing what to do and where to go. Now, that may still happen locally in some places, but as I said earlier on, the bigger challenge is those areas where we have settlements mixed with forests. For example, most of the areas around Athens, most of the areas around Thessaloniki, where that's not going to work. And where we need to be establishing those local prevention plans that are very, very clear in who is responsible for doing what months before the forest fire breaks out. And I think that's a big part of the success there. On the issue of rehabilitation or regeneration, let me say this. Again, I'm not a big fan of reforestation, of technical reforestation, because I do think that natural regeneration, in most cases, can be the solution. We're actually in the process now of just completing an analysis on a national level of the areas that have been burned two or three times, the areas that now have weak soil, and where, if reforestation were to take place, technically, those are the areas that should actually be priority areas. It'll be, I think, a Sisyphean effort if we just allow our forests to burn every year only to reforest them afterwards. And unfortunately, I must say, if one looks historically at the areas that have been reforested in the past, Pedeli is a fantastic example, you will see 93, 95, 98, 2000, 2003,
fantastic is hardly the word.
Areas that have been planted and then burned again. So we need to do what we can do to actually give nature the chance to regenerate, I think, naturally, and that's the key.
Thank you very much, Dimitri. We only have 4 minutes, so I just want to share with you one thought that I have in mind, and then you will have each 1 minute to say the closing point that you want to make. On this thing of coexisting with forests, yes, we have to allow nature, but as we all know, Mediterranean systems are based on the coexistence of humans and natural systems. And in this case, I believe that engaging everyone in the proper way on how they do it is very important. We, as an international organization, the European Public Law Organization, are willing to engage with all of you, and I have had these discussions with you, to see how a proper governance can also be supported through the tools that we have. We have the funding from RRF, we have knowledge, we have institutions. We need to give the tools to everyone to be involved in the proper way, at the proper time, and in the proper way, so that we not only have to deal with the suppression part. Now, as a last point that each one of you will do in 1 minute, some people here in the beginning said that they have lived through the experience of having the beauty of a forest, the sounds of it, the smells of it, the magic of being in a forest. What would you tell them on how we will all work together in the next years with the funding, with the tools and everything that we have to make sure that we have a better forest policy in the future than what Dimitris described as failure cases in the past 20 or more years? Theodora, I will start with you again as an elected member of the parliament.
Thank you very much. It is definitely up to the government and the local authorities to create the foundations for this sustainable forest management. However, forest is our house, is the basis that we're able to breathe, to live, to prosper. So we need to protect the forest through a collaborative approach. Every one of us could participate in this national reforestation project, and every one of us could actually embrace and protect the forest, the trees in his or her neighborhood. So we need all together to work. And the Environment Committee of the Parliament is actually the place where all civilians could actually come and work with us.
Thank you so much. We'll take you up on this. When we start working on the bigger governance part, you will have to play a central part. Secretary General for Forests in Greece, Konstantinos Aravossis.
Yes. First of all, I would like to say that our focus is on smart and sustainable forests. Smart, I have commented on that, but sustainable is actually what we want to have. Because, as you know, there are various occupations that work in the forest. There are all different products that you can use and extract from the forest, and this is also good for nature, it is good for the environment. So for us, it should be a priority to have forest management plans for all forests of the country. This is very important because through these plans, we will identify for each forest area exactly how we can manage this forest in a way so that it can become the center of the economy of the area, which is very important. And this is, it will help in the economy, but also people that will work in these forests, they will effectively protect it. So for us, this is how we see it, smart and sustainable.
I'm afraid that again, Dimitris will agree with you. So Dimitri, please.
Well, when I think about this country 10 years from now, I'd like to imagine and hope that we've changed that paradigm, and prevention is actually the key. But I would go to one particular area, and that's Evia. That's the largest fire that we've ever seen, single fire in this country. And it's an area where people lived in the forest, from the forest. And I would hope that in 10 years from now, that region has been regenerated naturally, and you know, honey is again produced there, resin is produced, and people are actually living in the forest and stewards of that forest in the best way.
Dimitri, thank you very much, and thank you all for your participation in this panel. Before I ask for a hand of applause, I'd like to ask all of you to stay here, because the next session I will have the privilege to be discussing with the Minister of Environment of North Macedonia, Mr. Nasir Nureddini. And it's our neighbor, and it's a country that we share a lot. We share the Prespa Lakes, for example, with our neighboring country. And we will have lots of interesting things to say. But before this, and because you will not get rid of me, but the other speakers will not be on the podium after that, please give me a hand of applause for our three speakers. Thank you so much.